The truth is that it's pretty unlikely that you need more than the M1 Mac Mini. It's not impossible, but it's unlikely. If you absolutely need the additional RAM, the storage, and the processing power, then it's a no-brainer. Go ahead and get the Mac Studio. But I want to talk about some reasons why you may want the Mac Studio, even if you don't need it. You see, both of these are very small and capable desktops. They have the same footprint, but the Mac Studio is a lot taller. It's almost like you took a few M1 Mac Minis and you made a sandwich, you know, like a Big Mac, but without getting sued. And for how I have my monitor set up, this additional height is not an issue, and I can easily fit both of these right under my monitor. Now, in order to put the features and benefits in context, I think we have to mention the price difference. We're looking at $700 for the base M1 Mac Mini versus $2,000 for the base M1 Max Mac Studio. And I'm always curious about prices outside of the US because sometimes there is such a discrepancy. So let me know where you're from and what the prices are where you live. Now, right off the bat, one of the major differences that we see between these two desktops is the ports. And there are some very important real life implications that go beyond specs. So let's quickly look at what we get. Now, the Mac Mini comes with two Thunderbolt 3/USB4 ports, two USB-A ports, an HDMI 2.0 port, a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, and a gigabit Ethernet port, which can be upgraded to a 10 gigabit port for an additional $100. The Mac Studio has two configurations, one for the M1 Max and one for the M1 Ultra. And the difference between the two is that the Ultra comes with 6 Thunderbolt 4 ports, and the Max comes with 4 Thunderbolt 4 ports, and two USB-C ports. Other than that, both Mac Studio models come with two USB-A ports, an HDMI port, a 10 gigabit Ethernet port, a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, and an SDXC card slot. So now let's talk about some practical differences. Now, the vast majority of Mac Mini users are likely to have one monitor that's connected via HDMI, and that leaves two free Thunderbolt 3 ports and two USB-A ports, which is going to be plenty. Again, I'm not talking about more demanding users, I'm talking about the average user. But if we start looking at a multi-display setup and we want to connect some more capable accessories, then it's worth looking at the Mac Studio. So first of all, you're simply getting more ports, which adds flexibility. On top of that, instead of having all the ports on the back, you actually get two ports on the front. So they're either two Thunderbolt 4 ports or two USB-C ports, depending on whether you got the M1 Max or the M1 Ultra. But this is really nice if you have accessories that you connect and disconnect all the time. For example, I have an external SSD that I always attach to my Mac Mini and now to my Mac Studio. And for that type of use case, I don't really care about the fact that it's plugged in the back because it always stays there. But I also have other SSDs that I move between devices. And in that situation, I like having the two ports on the front because it's so much more convenient. Now, I mentioned displays, and there's another super important and very real difference. So the M1 Mac Mini is limited to two displays. One that's up to 6K and one that's up to 4K. And this will be just fine for a lot of users. But if you want native support for more monitors, the Mac Studio can support up to 5 displays. 4 of them can be 6K 60 hertz, plus an additional 4K 60 hertz display. Now I have 7 monitors connected to my main workstation, so I'm not judging how many monitors you want or need, but I just wanna make sure that you're making a choice that's gonna work for you. Now personally, I also really appreciate having the SDXC card slot on the front. Those are the cards that I use with all of my cameras, and I love not having to occupy another port, and I appreciate the cleaner overall setup because I don't need to have a card reader on my desk. And for my Mac Mini, I ended up getting this USB-C hub. It gives me ports on the front, gives me a card reader, and I eventually upgraded to the version that has a built-in SSD enclosure. And this brings me to the next set of differences, starting with internal storage. So the M1 Mac Mini caps out at 2 terabytes of storage versus 8 terabytes on the Mac Studio. For my workflow, this isn't super meaningful. 2 terabytes is plenty for what I need to house locally, and for long-term storage, even 8 terabytes on the Mac Studio wouldn't be enough. Just to give you an idea, my Synology setup has over 36 terabytes of storage. But if your needs are somewhere between 2 and 8 and you don't want to use an external SSD, that would be a reason to go with the Mac Studio. Another potentially important limitation has to do with unified memory. So the M1 Mac Mini is limited to 16 gigabytes, and the Mac Studio can go up to 64 gigabytes if you get the M1 Max, and then up to 128 gigabytes with the M1 Ultra. If you actually need 64 or 128 gigabytes of unified memory, then you're in a different league and you wouldn't even be looking at the Mac Mini. Now, the one area where I can see some overlap is the choice between 16 and 32 gigabytes. And I'll come back to this later on after I talk about performance, because this is where things get a little bit sticky. Now, when you quickly look at the specs, the M1 comes with an 8-core CPU, 4 are high-performance cores, and 4 are high-efficiency cores. And it always comes with an 8-core GPU, so that's pretty straightforward. As you would expect, it's going to work great for essentially every type of general office type work, and for browsing the web, for watching video, for email, those types of things are gonna work great. But at the same time, I've edited photos in Lightroom and Photoshop, I've edited 4K video with color grading, and I've had no issues in terms of responsiveness, lag, I can scrub the timeline without any issues, and everything has worked well. Now, that's not to say that there aren't advantages with the Mac Studio, so let's get to them. Now, first of all, there are different configurations available, depending on whether you get the M1 Max or the Ultra. The M1 Max comes with a 10-core CPU, but 8 of them are high performance and only 2 are high efficiency. So we're getting double the high performance cores and half as many high efficiency cores as we have on the M1. Now the M1 Ultra comes with a 20-core CPU with 16 high performance cores and 4 high efficiency cores. So in both cases, that's gonna give the Mac Studio a massive advantage in some areas, but not in every case. So if we look at single core performance, the numbers are virtually identical. So performance for simple tasks that only utilize a single core isn't really gonna be any different. And even for a lot of my work in Photoshop, Premiere, and Final Cut Pro, I didn't notice a major difference. But when I do things like batch process photos or render videos, then I do notice the Mac Studio completing those tasks in less time. The question you should ask yourself is, how often do you do those types of things? I'm going to use video editing as a general example, but you can extrapolate from there. So for me, having a smooth video editing experience is much more important than faster render times, because I edit for 5 or 6 hours and I only export once. So whether that export takes 6 or 10 minutes doesn't really matter to me. Like, in both cases, I'm just gonna go get coffee, and by the time I'm back, it's going to be done. It's also something that only needs to be done 2 or 3 times a week, so that improvement has limited value. On the other hand, if I was doing this with larger projects or several times a day, then render times would be more important. Now, other examples where the M1 Max and Ultra are beneficial, things like adding a lot of motion graphics or VFX, if you do 3D rendering. I know that my musician friend loves the additional ports for all types of accessories. He loves the additional unified memory for all his plugins and virtual instruments. So if your workflow is bottlenecked by processing power or by hardware limitations, then the Mac Studio is definitely the way to go. Now, I'm a big believer in creating a workflow with the least amount of friction so that you can be more productive with less frustration. You'll also be getting increased memory bandwidth as you move up in the M1 lineup. You probably won't be surprised to hear the GPU performance is also better on the Mac Studio, because we're getting up to 32 GPU cores on the M1 Max and up to 64 on the M1 Ultra versus 8 cores on the M1. But it's also important that we look at the cost in order to put that performance difference in context. So the M1 Mac Mini starts at $699 with 8 gigabytes of unified memory and 256 gigabytes of storage. The Mac Studio with the base M1 Max sells for $2,000, but it comes with 16 gigabytes of unified memory and 512 gigabytes of storage. So we're looking at a $1,300 difference. If you actually wanted to match up the storage and memory, then you'd have to add $400 to the Mac Mini, which would put you at $1,099. And if you wanted the 10 gigabit port, that's an extra $100. So now we're at $1,199. So we're looking at somewhere between $1,300 and an $800 difference. Now, if you need more than 16 gigabytes of RAM or more than 2 terabytes of internal storage, then your only choice is to go with the Mac Studio and then choose the right value in terms of CPU, GPU, and Neural Engine cores. If you don't necessarily need the performance boost, but you just want more than 2 displays, you want more ports, you want an SDXC card slot, and more convenient access to the ports on the front, then you need to look at whether that added convenience is worth the additional expense. The vast majority of users can easily get by with an M1 Mac Mini and then a hub for additional ports and for better access. It's significantly less expensive and they can use that extra cash for a nice display, keyboard, and a mouse. And remember that single core performance is the same. So for everyday tasks, you're not going to notice a difference. I would recommend going with 16 gigabytes of unified memory, and I would get enough storage to last you, because remember that neither of these can be upgraded in the future. Of course, if you're in that top echelon of users and you need the best compact desktop that Apple makes, the Mac Studio is an absolutely fantastic choice. It'll chew through those demanding multi-core tasks, and it should easily last you for many years to come. I wish that there was an M1 Mac Mini with 32 gigabytes of unified memory, or a Mac Mini with the M1 Pro chip, which could be upgraded to 32 gigabytes and then give access for additional displays. That would be an incredible option. And I can't wait to see what Apple does with the next Mac Mini. Now you should watch this M2 versus M1 comparison. Click on my face to subscribe. You know what I always say, buy it nice or buy it twice. Good luck and see you soon.